Welcome to the Genealogy Gems Podcast, providing quick and innovative ways to make the absolute most out of your research time and creative ideas for sharing and displaying your family history. I'm your host, Lisa Louise Cook. Welcome, friends, to the 60th episode of the Genealogy Gems Podcast. And we're going to be having some extra fun today as the Genealogy Gems Podcast becomes a toddler. That's right. This episode marks the second birthday of the show.
Surprise! Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
So we're going to have some fun today, and I have invited a very special guest to attend the party. In fact, you may even know him.
Daniel Boone was a man, yes, a big man, with an eye like an eagle and as tall as a mountain was he. From the coonskin cap on the top of old Dan to the heel of his rawhide shoe, the rippin'est, roarin'est, fightin'est man, the frontier ever.
No, it's not Daniel Boone, but it's someone who knew him well. Well, at least he knew the TV Daniel Boone, and that's Darby Hinton, who played the son of Daniel Boone on the hit TV series that ran from 1964 to 1970. Darby is currently working on a television pilot for a new series called Hinton Living History, which sounds right up our alley. In part one of my interview with Darby, we talk about his TV career, which started before he could even walk, and landed him in movies like The Son of Flubber, and later on, TV shows like Mr. Ed, Wagon Train, The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet, and The Big Valley. And of course, we all know him as Isreal, the son of Daniel Boone, played by the wonderful Fess Parker. This is one guy who had a fascinating childhood, meeting the likes of Walt Disney, and having Charleton Heston as a godfather.
You know, I kind of grew up doing it before I really knew what I was doing. It was just a way of life. I must have been about 3 years old or something, and we were on the Disney lot, and Walt was walking across, and Mom's like, "Oh, there's Mr. Disney. Go say hi to him. Go tell him you want to be in a movie. Go tell him, you know." And I didn't know, so I watched him. "Hi, I'd like to be in one of your movies."
Then in the next episode, we'll climb the Hinton family tree, and I'll share my research findings with Darby and his lovely wife, Sean. Darby's curiosity about his family tree was piqued during a recent visit to North Carolina, where he was shooting a documentary about the real life of Daniel Boone. The Hinton clan's North Carolina roots run pretty deep, and I'll be adding the names of his direct ancestors to that family tree.
I'm just fascinated how this history is coming alive, and that's why I value so much what you do, because I look at it, and it's just like, you know, it's like a puzzle that I don't know how to put together. it's very frustrating at times.
And in the final segment of the interview, in episode 62, Darby's TV resume and newfound interest in history merge into an exciting new television show that involves his entire family, called Hinton Living History. Darby and his wife, Sean, and their four kids strike out into the heart of America to explore history firsthand, hoping to inspire families across the country to do the same.
Well, it's like I said, I've had this fascination with the history, and it just kind of got to me that the kids, I'll just speak about my kids, didn't really care about it. "Oh, history's boring, who cares," and this, and so what I'm trying to do now is not only get them away from the computer games and off the couch, but to show other families how they can go do it.
But before we chat with Darby, I have some more exciting news. Linda Sham of Illinois is the winner of the two free genealogy classes courtesy of genclass.com. Congratulations, Linda. As you'll recall, genealogy instructor Lisa Alzo visited with us in episode 29, and she talked about the wide range of genealogy classes that you can find online at genclass.com. And what's really unique about these classes is that you can email questions and you can interact with your genealogy expert instructor throughout the class. Linda was randomly drawn from all of our email entries and will be selecting two classes from their curriculum. And many thanks to all of you who entered by email. The entries included terrific topics for future episodes of the Genealogy Gems podcast, and I'm already putting some of them into motion. You know, this show is for you, and so it just makes sense that we cover the genealogical topics that you want to learn more about. So thanks again, everyone. Thanks to Gen Class, and congratulations, Linda. Now we are off to the mailbox. I got an email recently from Teresa Redway, who says that she's recently found the podcast. And she writes, "I've been researching my family history for a few years now, and I'm pleased to hear a few pointers which have helped me over a couple of brick walls." Oh, that's good news. She says, "Now I'm writing to ask you for your help and your insight. My great-great-grandparents seem to have tried immigrating to the USA, but for some reason didn't stay very long. As was usual back then, they had a child every 2 years, and just one of them was born in the U.S. He grew up to become my great-grandfather. Both my great-great and great-grandfathers were bootmakers, and in his turn, great-grandfather took his family, including my grandfather, traveling to find work, though they always seemed to end up back in Bristol, England, which is my hometown. In great-grandfather's case, they went to Wales, making and repairing boots for the miners and coming back when that industry collapsed. So, can you help? What would have drawn great-grandfather all the way to Pittsburgh, Allegheny County, USA, around 1870? Here are some details. Isaac Lovell, L-O-V-E-L-L, born 1844 in Bristol, England, and Jane, his wife, was born in 1845. They probably traveled over with their children, Emmeline, born 1865, and Sydney, born 1867. Though I guess that they may have left them at home. And the boy born in the U.S. was Alfred Ernest Lovell, born 18 June 1871. They don't show up in the British 1871 census. Any help or guidance that you can offer would be welcome. Well, Teresa, I think I can help you out a bit, and I want to share some of my ideas here in the mailbox segment because I think that some of these tactics could help other folks who are listening. You know, it's always good to get a fresh pair of eyes to take a look at a family tree challenge that you're working on, and sometimes that will generate some new research leads. So let's see what we can do. First, I focused on the family's immigration, and I asked Teresa what sources that she was working from. And she told me that her main sources are the stories that her great-uncle, Alfred's youngest son, told her, and that Alfred gives Pittsburgh, USA, as his place of birth in the British census. She also said that Alfred appears in the IGI on FamilySearch.org as Alfred Lovell, born 1871, USA, and that she hasn't found records of their immigration yet. So I headed to Ancestry.com to see if I could come up with their immigration record. And sure enough, Isaac Lovell wasn't showing up. So I decided to look for Jane instead, and sure enough, I hit the jackpot. But interestingly, the family was listed as Alfred, Jane, and their kids, daughter Emmeline, age 4, and son Sydney, age 1. Now, Alfred was not the name that we were expecting to see. This family departed Liverpool and arrived in New York on November 9, 1870, aboard the SS Nebraska. So this date of November 1870 explains why Teresa hasn't been able to find them in the 1870 U.S. federal census, because enumeration for that census began on June 1st, 1870, and it wrapped up about 5 months later, which of course was just right around November 1st. So they must have just missed it. So why is the husband listed as Alfred and Jane is the wife on the passenger list? Well, Alfred's age caught my eye. He was listed as age 20, while Jane was 25, and their oldest child was 4 years old. So if Alfred were Emmeline's father, he would have been about 16 years old when she was born. Probably not likely. So after sending this information to Teresa, she thought she might know the real story. As it turns out, Isaac had a younger brother named Alfred, and she has the marriage record for Isaac and Jane in 1865, so she knows that Jane did marry Isaac. And of course, Jane and Isaac were listed together after coming back to England in the British census later on. And finally, Teresa has a record of Alfred marrying in 1871 back in England. That's pretty darn soon after an immigration date of November 1870. That would have Alfred marrying in England probably in within a year or less of the time that he supposedly made the journey across the Atlantic to the U.S. The idea being that maybe Isaac went over first and Alfred just accompanied his family. Teresa wondered if Isaac might have immigrated first and then was followed by his wife and children accompanied by his little brother. She hypothesized that it might have been easier for them to travel as husband and wife, and that certainly is a possibility if that indeed was Alfred. We can work with the birth date of the third child, who was Alfred Ernest Lovell, who was born in America on the 18th of June, 1871. Now, if we count back 9 months from June 18th, we can guess that he was conceived around September 18th, 1870. And if that's the case, we should be able to find a passenger list for Isaac traveling between England and America between mid-September and November 9th. And if that's the case, we should be able to find a passenger list for Isaac traveling between England and America no earlier than mid-September and no later than November 9th. And of course, it's possible that the pregnancy was not a full 9 months, so it could be any time in between there. However, my initial search on a wide variety of variations on the name Isaac Lovell resulted in absolutely no Isaac Lovells that make any kind of a close match at all. Now, that doesn't mean he didn't make the journey, but it does cause me to wonder if there might have been some reason why Isaac would have represented himself as Alfred, his younger brother, when getting on the ship. Could he have perhaps been in some kind of difficulty that he was trying to escape? I mean, this could be criminal, legal, financial in nature, who knows? So while we've answered some of the question by finding this first passenger list, which is great, there are certainly more questions remaining. So my recommendation is to investigate both Isaac and Alfred further in England. Now, one avenue that Teresa might take would be to look through the church records back in England where the family attended church and see if by chance Alfred, the younger brother of Isaac, is listed as the witness at any births or marriages during that time from November of 1870 for about the next year up until he got married. If he is, then she'll have more support for the idea that Isaac, for whatever reason, assumed Alfred's identity when leaving the country. And therefore, them naming their next child, who was born in the U.S., Alfred, does make some sense. Now, since Teresa is in the United Kingdom, she asked me how to go about locating a birth record for Jane and Isaac's son, Alfred, who was born in the U.S. As you'll recall, Alfred was born in Pittsburgh in Allegheny County in Pennsylvania. So a good way to go about this is to start with the Allegheny County U.S. Gen website to find out more about the records that are available in that county, as well as the history of the county, which might shed some light on what the draw was to her ancestors for going there. So I'll have a link directly to the Allegheny County page on the U.S. Gen website in the show notes. I also like the vitalrecords.com website at vitalrec.com, where you can click through to Pennsylvania and then to Allegheny County to find out more information on the vital records for that county. As it turns out, the Carnegie Library of Pittsburgh in Allegheny County, Pennsylvania, holds birth records for Pittsburgh from 1870 to 1905. So you are right in there under the wire with that 1871. You can order a birth record for about $5 U.S., which is a non-refundable fee for search and copy of a birth record. The payment requirements and the mailing address are available on the website, and of course, again, I'll have links directly to those pages in the show notes. Now, I think that Teresa's question about what was going on in Allegheny County, Pennsylvania in 1870 that would have drawn the family over was a good one. That's where the local and world history kind of collide with our family history, right? Well, thankfully, there are lots of options for checking this angle online. Teresa can check out what was going on in Pennsylvania between 1869 and 1874 at the Explore Pennsylvania History website at explorepahistory.com. And the about.com website has a timeline on Pittsburgh history as well at pittsburgh.about.com. And more specifically, you can go to /library/bltimeline.htm. And the Carnegie Library of Pittsburgh also has a chronology of the city's history and lots of other great info at clpgh.org. Now, y'all know that I also host the Family Tree Magazine podcast. I love working with them because I love the magazine. They have such great, usable information in the articles for family historians. And sure enough, the other day I was reading my March 2009 issue, and I came across the article called Hard Times by Fern Glazer on page 29. And in that article, I came across a potential reason for why the family returned to England. There was something called the Panic of 1873 in the United States. The article explained how a second transcontinental railway called the Northern Pacific Railroad collapsed in 1873. And shortly thereafter, the Philadelphia banking firm of J. Cook & Company, and yep, that's Cook with an E, announced on September 18th that it would suspend payment on notes after having invested heavily in the railway. That set off a chain of events resulting in the Long Depression, which lasted until 1879. So there you have it. We've taken a family mystery, we've answered a few questions, probably created a few more, and have come up with some tangible next steps that can be taken to further uncover that mystery. So thanks so much for writing, Teresa, and keep us informed on how your search is going. And finally, in the mailbox, I received an email from listener Tim Cox, who wrote in to say that he had heard an idea recently that he thought would benefit listeners. It was an idea from a librarian saying that lots of people will go off and leave their flash drives in the computers or laying on tables at the library. And her recommendation for a way to hopefully help that flash drive make its way back home to the original owner was a nice, simple one. She suggested putting a file on your flash drive that identifies that it belongs to you. So Tim said that he created a Word document and he named it, "This flash drive belongs to Tim Cox," and he included his telephone number. Then when you open up the document, it reads, "This flash drive belongs to Tim Cox," with his email address and his phone number. I think this is a terrific idea, Tim, and I appreciate you sharing it with all of us. Of course, not that any of us would ever set our flash drive down at a library and forget it. I mean, okay, maybe once I did. Well, actually it was my purse, but I don't know, that's another story. Looking for a way to get even more genealogy gems that will power boost your research, inspire your creativity, and give you the motivation you need to tackle that brick wall? Become a Genealogy Gems premium member and start reaping the benefits right away. And by entering the coupon code SAVE20, you can get 20% off the annual membership. You'll get 2 extra members-only episodes every month packed with great information you can use right away, an instructional video series walking you through the best internet tools and family history projects step by step. And membership is not only educational, it's fun. You can synergize with other listeners in the message forum and even try your hand at the genealogy-themed crossword puzzles. If you enjoy the Genealogy Gems podcast, then you're going to love being a Genealogy Gems premium member. But don't just take my word for it. Here's what your fellow Genealogy Gems podcast listeners have to say.
Thank you very much for your wonderful podcast. It's helped me out immensely.
Keep up the good work. Thanks again for everything that you do and for bringing things into a new perspective.
I'm calling because I wanted to tell you how much I enjoyed episode number 4. Thanks.
Thank you, Lisa. I learned so much from your podcast and look forward to each new episode.
To become a premium member and start reaping the benefits right away, go to www.genealogygems.tv and click the Join Today button. Be sure and type in the special coupon code SAVE20, that's SAVE20, and you'll get 20% off the annual membership. Don't drive through your research with the handbrake on. Go full throttle by being a Genealogy Gems premium member. Recently on Facebook, I posted a note asking if anyone remembered the Daniel Boone TV series and dropped a little hint that I had something up my sleeve on the subject. Well, podcast listener and Facebook friend Brenda Moore posted a reply saying that she did indeed remember the show, and she shared a little story about it. She wrote, "My brother has a son who used to like watching it. That is 35 years ago or so. The son wanted to help Daniel with a hammer one day, and the conclusion of that was there was never a TV in the house until about 10 years ago or so. Too much involvement, they decided. Thanks for the memory." Well, there was another little boy back then that was helping Daniel, as Brenda put it. Darby Hinton was just 7 years old when he signed on to play Isreal, the son of Daniel Boone, which ran from September 24th, 1964, to September 10th, 1970, on NBC. And over 165 episodes, he worked and he played alongside the 6-foot-6-inch actor Fess Parker on the film sets in California and Utah. Now, I was a very little girl when the series aired, but rather than pretending to be Daniel, I spent hours and hours in the backyard pretending to be Rebecca, the strong and lovely wife of Daniel Boone. My friends and I actually took our old wooden sandbox and we turned it up on its side, kind of facing the backyard side fence, and we draped an old blanket from the sandbox over across to the fence, and that was our cabin in old Kentucky. Of course, many years later, in 2005, I actually got the opportunity, along with my husband and kids, to do some real pioneer living when we appeared in the PBS miniseries Texas Ranch House. So when I heard that Darby and his family were working on a new TV history show called Hinton Living History, where they participate in reenactments and they share their living history experiences with the viewing audience, I knew that we had some things in common to talk about. In this episode, you'll hear part one of my three-part interview with Darby Hinton and his lovely wife, Shawn. Today, we are going to start back at the beginning as Darby shares his memories of how he broke into the TV business and what it was like to be working on the set of Daniel Boone. Darby, I know that your father was actor Ed Hinton.
Yes.
And he appeared in a lot of the early television series like The Lone Ranger and The Adventures of Rin Tin Tin and Perry Mason. So I guess it makes a lot of sense to me why you got into the business as well. But I know that your father died when you were just about 1 year old. What was your childhood like? And can you tell us a little bit about the influence he may have played on your later television career?
That's why I started in the business when I was 6 months old, just as a joke, actually. My dad used to always say, because I had two sisters and they started when they were a year old and, you know, doing commercials and stuff. So when I came around, you know, people would say, well, what about your son? Are you going to get him into it? And he'd be like, oh, the kid's 2 months old and he hasn't earned a dollar yet. I don't know. The kid's a bum. And, you know, and that was kind of his joke, which drove my mom crazy. So she got me into a Playhouse 90, actually with Jane Mansfield, and didn't tell him about it or anything. And he was going to go out and play golf, and she's like, no, we have a friend that's on this show. You got to sit and watch it. So he sat and watched it and didn't say a word and saw me come out. And at the end of it, he just turned to her and said, Marilyn, you sure know how to ruin a joke, don't you?
So she'd already put you to work.
That's it. So, you know, I kind of grew up doing it before I really knew what I was doing. It was just a way of life.
Well, and you were really growing up in that whole
kind of Hollywood scene, weren't you? I mean, I was looking into some background on you, and weren't you even like Tyrone Powers was your godfather or something?
No, actually, Charleton Heston was my godfather.
Charleton Heston, not bad company.
No, not at all. But Tyrone Power, yes, as a matter of fact, his daughter, Romina Power, Romina and Karen, my sister is named Darren after Taryn, one of his daughters, and then Romina, who's actually out here now, is still good friends. And we see her, absolutely. I have pictures of us, you know, vacationing with Lucille Ball. Errol Flynn was a great friend of the family. And yes, my mom was kind of part of the Hollywood elite. She and Jane Russell started WAIF, which was the first International Adoption Association. So that's just who I grew up with. That was part of life.
Now, that's interesting because in looking up your father, you know, I can see that he did a lot of different spots on television series. But tell me a little bit about your mom, because she must have been become even a stronger influence in your life after your father passed away.
Absolutely. And she was a very strong woman, too. And, you know, she always said that was one of the reasons she wanted to keep me in the business, is because I didn't have a dad and I just had two older sisters. And with all the women, she wanted to find a way to have a lot of men in my life to as role models. And as fate would have it, you know, I ended up with Fess Parker, who I think is just a fabulous role model and just a great, actually, I talked to him today. And, you know, just talk about family values and just a great man to be around. He was one of the best. I couldn't have picked a better adopted dad.
And I would guess that that's probably the question you get asked most often, isn't it, is what was Fess Parker like as kind of your adoptive dad?
Yeah, a lot of people do, because, you know, was he as nice as he was? And I'm like, absolutely. The only time at one point he told me he was going to run for senator. I'm like, Fess, you're too nice to be a politician. What are you thinking? So, yes, he was a great guy. He is a great guy. He was a great substitute dad for that time. And actually, I got to spend more time with him than his own son, Eli, who's a great guy, too, and running a vineyard up there. Because, you know, if you think about it, we were on the set together all day while, you know, his son was at school and everything. So we really got to spend a lot of time together.
Wow, what an interesting scenario that turned out to be, that you lost your dad, you end up spending time with him, and he seemed like such a, I mean, obviously he was playing a role, but you still get the sense that there was kind of this steady character in him, that he was just kind of pretty much clear with his integrity and his character, and was he really like that in real life? And
he is. It's exactly what he's like.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
He's a really amazing man.
And he's one of the people that instilled the love of history in me. You know, we hadn't kept touch for a while, and then I went up and saw him at his vineyard, and it happened to be around the 4th of July, and he was throwing a party, and he asked me if I would read some things for the people that were gathered there. And it was all on history, and it was the fact that all the people that signed the Declaration of Independence, really what happened to them, how they were hunted down and a lot of them, you know, executed, most of them, all their worldly possessions were taken away, they had to run into hiding.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's that part of history that a lot of people don't know or really appreciate.
We don't realize that most of them lost their lives for standing up for what they believed in.
Absolutely. And not only standing up for what they believed in, but standing up to give this new country a great foundation and a real basis.
How wonderful. So he's running a vineyard now? I mean, does he have a winery business, or what's he up to these days?
Yeah, Fess Parker Wine, which is a wonderful wine. And as a matter of fact, a lot of people know his vineyard from the movie Sideways, because most of that was filmed in his vineyard.
Oh, okay. And I often think of Ed Ames as well. Now, he was in the series as well, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
And what was he like?
Ed was great. I hadn't really run across Ed since we ended up since the show ended. And when they started releasing the Daniel Boone on DVDs, we all went up to the vineyard, and also Fess owns a lovely hotel in Santa Barbara, and up there too.
Yeah.
And we were up there and threw a party and all got together. And it was wonderful because we sat around the piano and Ed started singing again, and his voice was just as clear and beautiful as it was back when he was with the Ames Brothers.
Wow. That's amazing. I know I've seen the hotel in Santa Barbara, and it's just beautiful and elegant and very much like we think of the man. And then Ed Ames, I remember him mostly from my mother playing his records.
Yes. And like I said, that voice is just still there, that dreamy voice. I mean, you know, when his cup runneth over and everything. And it's fun. We've talked a couple of times since.
Oh, that's wonderful. Now, I know that you played Isreal Boone from, what, 1964 to 1970?
You know I did it for 6 years. I'm not that great with dates and exactly when everything happened, but I know it was the 60s into the early 70s.
Yeah, that's about 6 years, and I know there were many, many episodes. Oh, my goodness, all the DVDs that are out. But you actually did have kind of a solid resume before you got that job. I mean, I know you mentioned that your mother got you to work pretty early, but I was looking, you did The Big Valley and Ozzie and Harriet and Mr. Ed, but you'd also worked with Disney, right?
Yes. I don't know. I must have been about 3 years old or something, and we were on the Disney lot, and Walt was walking across, and Mom's like, "Oh, that's Mr. Disney. Go say hi to him. Go tell him you want to be in a movie. Go tell him, you know." And I didn't know, so I walked him, "Hi, I'd like to be in one of your movies." And he looked down and was like, "I don't know, kid. You look kind of young. I don't know if you can carry any dialogue." Well, I didn't know what that meant, but I thought I was being insulted. So I just looked back and said, "I'm strong. I can carry anything." So that cracked him up. He goes, "Kid, go to wardrobe." And he put me in Son of Flubber.
Right, right.
So that was the first thing I got to do for him.
Well, I imagine with that towhead blonde hair and the freckles, you had the perfect all-American face for it. And so you met him in person, and I'm curious to know, you had that experience of working with a lot of different people. You're at such a young age. I can't even imagine. It must be difficult to even remember it in a straight line. I know I don't remember my childhood all that clearly. It's in more bits and spurts. Do you find it the same way? You remember those moments, but not necessarily the continuity of it?
Oh, absolutely. And that was one of the fascinating things when the Boone DVDs came out, is I watched some of the episodes that I obviously hadn't seen since they aired. I'm like, "Oh, yeah, I remember that." And there are actors that I forgot that I worked with. I mean, I was a fan of Bewitched, and I didn't realize that I worked with the second Darren and did a whole scene with him. And of course, I did remember Vincent Price because he scared the heck out of me. The fact that I was going to work with him, nicest man I ever met, but just the fact that he was going to be on the set scared me to death.
Now, did he play a dastardly man on the show?
He played, it was kind of a Oliver Twist,
and
that Finnegan thing where he kind of kidnapped me and I was part of the boys in the gang. So, yeah, he was a little dastardly.
But a sweetheart in person, huh?
Oh, absolutely. Like I said, I was scared to death when I knew, because I still to this day don't like scary movies, and I just don't go to them.
Yeah.
And I was, like, trying to avoid him and stay away because I had seen just a little bit of The House of Wax.
Oh, so you knew that he was in those
movies. Oh, I knew, and I knew he was a scary man. And that's one of the things, like you say, the little moments you remember. I remember sitting in my chair, kind of going over my script, and all of a sudden this hand was on my shoulder, and I turned around, and it was him. I'm like, "Oh," and he goes, "Darby, could I just ask you a favor? My daughter really thinks you're great. Would you sign an autograph for me?"
Oh, wow. Isn't that sweet?
So that was wonderful.
And that must have really been like kind of watching a visual history of yourself, if you will. I mean, my gosh, 6 years captured on film. Obviously, you're playing a character, but you're remembering it from the aspect of what was going on behind the scenes and the people that were involved. It must have been kind of a little journey back in time for you when the DVDs came out.
Oh, absolutely. Like I say, I now see the actors that I was working with that I admired that I forgot that I had worked with.
Right. Now, I'm curious, obviously, the story was set in a historical context. Do you have any sense of how important the history was to the to the crew? I mean, was that a priority, or was it just really to entertain the audience?
Well, I think Fess tried to keep it a little bit more. Actually, the fascinating thing is we've already shot one of the segments of a three-part documentary that we're doing on the real Daniel Boone, and it's called In the Footsteps of Boone, where we go back to where his actual cabins were. We've already shot the North Carolina segment of it.
Oh.
And then this spring we're going to go back and shoot the Kentucky, where we're actually going to go back to Fort Boonesboro, and then we'll do one after that in Missouri, where he ended up. And what I'm loving, because now I get to do all this research on the real Daniel Boone, who never wore a coonskin cap, who, sold ginseng, traded slaves, was known as having the most lawsuits against him than any other man in the county, but
wow.
At the same time was a judge. All these wonderful contradictions where, you know, he loved the wilderness and he loved the openness, but yet he was known for killing, 80 bears in one season.
Mm-hmm.
And so now to see what the Hollywood version of Daniel Boone was compared to what the real version of Boone was is really a great comparison.
In your research, have you kind of discovered why that transformation happened? Why Hollywood latched on to him and how he kind of morphed into this other type of character?
Well, I mean, that's always Hollywood. They always, try to put their own spin on it. I did find out that actually Davy Crockett was told to wear a coonskin cap to try to be more like Daniel Boone. Because Daniel Boone was really the first American living legend, where they started writing books and telling stories about him while he was still alive, and he became very famous.
Oh.
All through Europe and, England and France, of this great American pioneer. And so I think people from there tried to kind of build on it.
That makes sense, that they were actually recording the story at the time, and it's always grander when it's a little more dressed up, I suppose.
That's it, absolutely. And, although his own exploits were, phenomenal, you have a man that, was known as a great Indian fighter, although he only remembers shooting one Indian in his life. You have him where, when he was going through the Cumberland Gap to try to settle Kentucky, one of his sons was in the back of the pack and actually captured by Indians and brutally tortured. And killed.
Oh.
And yet Daniel never went after that Indian to get any revenge on him. And even there was one point where he saw that Indian later with a group of men, and he's like, be careful of that one. And then again, when he was in Boonesboro, his daughter Jemima was kidnapped, and he ran out of the house barefoot and tracked the Indians down. I think he eventually got some shoes, but he started and tracked the Indians down for 4 days before he caught up, killed all the Indians, and got not only his daughter, but the two other girls that were captured along with her. So he was really a fascinating person that lived between really three different worlds. There was the Americans, he lived with the Indians, and then also the Spanish and the French.
Mm-hmm.
And he managed to blend in with all of these cultures. And he was captured a number of times by the Indians. And actually, they tried to bring him up, some of the Americans tried to bring him up for treason because some things he did to save his own men, some other people said was cowardly, but he did end up not only saving his own men, but all the people in Boonesboro because of a deal he made where he actually let him capture instead of going down, and the Indians were poised to kill all these people that were all at the salt flats where they were making salt to bring back.
Mm-hmm.
He said, well, let me go down. I'll have them surrender if you promise not to kill or torture. It's actually a funny story because he talked to the Indian chief and he said, I will have them surrender to you as long as you promise not to kill or torture any of them. So they agreed to it. So that's why some of the men say that, he was a traitor and turned him in. But when they brought him back, all of a sudden, the Indians started making this long gauntlet, which is what you had to run through, and they could hit you with tomahawks
right.
and beat you up. And he looked at it, and I got very mad. He said, you promised me that none of my men would have to run the gauntlet. And they looked at him and said, oh, that's not for your men. It was for him.
Oh, my gosh.
They made him run the gauntlet.
Wow. Now, obviously, you have really come to embrace the history and become very familiar with it. Did your interest in history begin back in the days when you were acting it out, or is that something that's kind of developed later in life?
Kind of a combination of the two. I remember loving to hear about real Indian history at the time. The Daniel Boone and the frontier part, maybe because I was living it, didn't interest me as much. But I would be able to get the real Indian history of it and the side that Hollywood wasn't telling, because the Americans didn't treat the Indians too well, if that's a surprise to anybody. But, you know, that was never really told in the show. And I would get to spend time in North Carolina living on the Cherokee reservations and have a lot of great friends growing up that were Indians. And I actually got to perform the play The Trail of Tears.
Oh, wow.
So that side of it interested me. But it really wasn't in the last few years that it's really come full circle, where it's just fascinated me. And maybe it's because I'm trying to get my kids a little bit more interested in it. And, you know, whenever you try to teach something, I think it's great to have a passion of it yourself.
Branches in the wind, still standing here together. One more storm to weather, we'll get through it yet. So we're gathered here, holding on to each other. To let go of another one we won't forget. Now as we say goodbye to one of our own, we may be lonely, but we're not alone. Though the leaves will fall and the tears will flow, may it always comfort us to know the family tree will always grow.
Thanks so much to Darby Hinton for joining me today on this very special 2-year anniversary show. I look forward to sharing part 2 of the interview with you next episode, where we talk about the Hintons that came before him. And I want to thank you for listening. You know, 2 years ago, when I turned the microphone on for the first time and sent this podcast out onto the internet, I didn't know if anyone was going to listen. But I had faith that if I shared my passion for family history from a true and honest place, then chances are folks would come and join me. And so many of you have, and I'm so very, very grateful. I mean it when I say, thanks for listening, friend, and I'll talk to you soon.
And when we say goodbye to one of our own, we may be lonely, but we're not alone. Though the leaves will fall and the tears will flow, may it always comfort us to know